Hello, welcome to How Good Is Politics, where we break down everything that's happened in the last week in federal politics. I'm Kerrie Yaxley, and joining us this week is Nine's Chris O'Keefe and Fergus Hunter from the Sydney Morning Herald and The Age. Welcome, your first time at How Good Is Politics, otherwise known as HGUP. As its acronym.
Thank you, great to be here in those lovely surroundings.
All right, let's go overseas first. And the US President Donald Trump has invited Scott Morrison to tea. It's not just any tea, he's been invited to a state dinner at the White House. Chris, this is a very big deal for our Prime Minister.
It's a big deal. It hasn't happened for many, many years. I think back when John Howard visited George W. Bush was the last time that Australian Prime Minister went over and was hosted to the big hoo-ha. I think that goes to show just how important Australia is, specifically in this Pacific, for the US, and act as a bit of a buffer to China, because if Donald Trump wants to continue his trade war with the Chinese, he certainly needs Australia in this part of the world doing their bidding. And I think that's a bit of a gesture from Donald Trump to say, hey, listen, you're still in our corner.
Yeah, so he's basically saying, like, look, ScoMo, I really like you. Like, you're a great bloke, but also I need you to do a really particular job in your region for us.
And you get a ribeye. As a result. Congratulations.
well done with tomato sauce, apparently Donald Trump's favourite way of doing it as well, which is interesting.
I thought he only ate McDonald's.
Well, that and a well-done steak with tea sauce, yeah, right. Which is interesting. But yeah, it does speak to that very important role, as you say. And also it's this, you know, unusual rapport that Morrison has managed to kind of strike up with Trump at a time when he has pretty poor relations with some other key world leaders, you know, thinking Theresa May, Angela Merkel, you know. So that's a credit to Morrison, and, you know, it's obviously important for Australia to have, you know, a solid relationship there, no matter what you think of the man himself.
Rightly or wrongly, Trump sees a bit of himself in Morrison, in the sense that it was the victory that no one thought possible, and he made it happen.
Maybe there seems to be a bit of that, doesn't there, where he was at their meeting, he was saying, you know, they said you couldn't do it, but I believed in you, you know, Scott, I knew you could do it.
Yeah. So you know, all that's garbage. You probably didn't even know what was happening, but nonetheless, I think there is a bit of a rapport there.
Someone told him 5 minutes before dinner. Yeah. By the way, this guy, no one expected him to win in Australia. He did. That's right, Australia. all right, so the PM on the weekend said that when he was asked what he admired about Donald Trump, he said that he admired him because he was a man of his word. He said it in other words, but words to that effect. However, the president's words sometimes get him into a bit of strife, particularly when he gets on Twitter. He attacked four Democratic congresswomen on Twitter. He's been accused of racism over this. Does the Prime Minister have to be a little bit careful not to get too close to Donald Trump? Is it bad PR, or is the fact that he's the American president just outweigh all of that?
I think so. I think the vast majority of Australians wouldn't have bought into what happened in Washington over the last few days. I think Scott Morrison is way too smart for that. Yep. He won't get himself involved in any of the controversy that surrounds Donald Trump. He's not going to buy into it. He certainly won't comment on it in any way, shape or form. Not our place. Leave that to the Yanks.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, and I mean, yes, so Trump's racist language there, it's a very big domestic political issue over in the States, rightfully so. He's essentially said to American citizens that aren't, you know, white, that they're not, you know, as much Americans as him. So yes, a big issue, but as you say, like, is it for the Australian leader to comment on that? You can debate that. Maybe not. What's to be served by it? What is to be served by Morrison going over there and meeting with Donald Trump is Australia's national interest. So what his job is to protect that. And we've seen the importance of having a strong relationship. You know, you go back to last year, this was pre-Morrison, but securing that exemptions from the steel and aluminium tariffs, that was very unique, a big exception to what happened globally. Now, whatever you think of what Trump does, whether it is in policy or in language, if Australia can secure those, you know, secure those wins in the national interest, that's a government doing its job.
Yeah, all right. Let's go back to domestic issues now. And the government acted on deeming rates finally over the weekend. It announced it's going to lower the deeming rates, meaning that around 600,000 pensioners will be up to $800 better off per week. Very brief, simple explanation of a deeming rate. Here I go. Okay. So the government assumes that pensioners earn a certain amount of interest on their investments, regardless of whether they do or not. Some pensioners who, say, have savings accounts or term deposits believed they were getting shortchanged by that because the official cash rate is so low at the moment. So the government has reduced the deeming rates, hopefully to the benefit of those people. Why didn't the government act? Well, first of all, how did my explanation go?
Good. Yeah, can good. I firstly say, yeah. No one under the age of 50 knew what deeming rates were before the last fortnight. But yeah, right. It is fascinating and it is super important.
Super important, yeah, yeah. Right? And why didn't we hear about this, say, during the election campaign, say, from Labor, for example?
Well, my understanding is it became particularly important after they dropped the cash rate, didn't it?
Right.
So
yes.
So the deeming rate does apply to any income you're receiving from your financial assets, and they make that estimate. But the key one here is, yes, what you're getting back from investments. And after the Reserve Bank dropped the cash rate, then now your problem is, well, government is overestimating all these incomes, and that's ripping off, as you say, those 600,000 pensioners and 300,000 or so people on other kinds of payments.
Yeah. So. It's quite a significant amount of money. It's $600 million over 4 years. Once the government moved on this, there was a bit of pressure suggesting that they should also move to lift the rate of Newstart, which hasn't been lifted in real terms in 25 years. Chris, why won't the government act on Newstart?
Well, surplus. That's the pure and simple, the surplus. They promised it's a back in black. They've got the mugs, they've got the hats, they've got all the merch to go with it. By hook or by crook, they are going to get a surplus when we get around to the budget next year. It is as simple as that. By raising Newstart, even if it does have a demonstrably successful impact yeah. on the economy,
yes.
if it impacts a surplus, it's not going to happen. Mm. And that's going to be the case when we put markers in the ground on all sorts of things. And when we saw the RBA governor coming out and saying, you need to bring forward infrastructure spending, well, they can bring forward infrastructure spending, but they're not going to be able to do it over the next 12 months because it'll impact the surplus. Can't happen.
Yeah, and I think there's also a bit of an ideological objection going on here as far as Newstart's concerned, because you know economists say, I think it was Deloitte that said, sure, it'd cost $3 billion initially, but that's money that would literally be in the economy because we're talking about some of the poorest Australians.
Exactly.
They have no choice but to spend that money.
Doesn't go into savings. That gets straight back into the market. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think, yes, obviously there is an ideological thing, but it does come down to the practical, yeah. I mean, there is a very wide coalition of people saying this needs to go up, through from the Business Council, former Liberal PM John Howard.
Barnaby Joyce?
Yeah, others.
What?
They people know it needs to go up.
Yeah.
It's not enough for an unemployed person to live on, not enough for them to be on a steady footing to go and try and get a job. They may be unemployed, of course, through no fault of their own. But it's that practical, that blow, the price tag, $3.3 billion. No one's going to sign up to that. Even pre-election, Labor couldn't bring themselves to commit to explicitly to raising the rate. They said it's too low and we're going to have a review.
Right.
But they wouldn't say, of course, we'll raise it.
Yeah.
So that hefty price tag, it's scary.
Mm. Yeah, yeah, it is a lot of money. Chris, you had an interesting story this week about the PATH program, a little bit dodgy.
Yeah, people don't really understand, I haven't heard about it. It's been written a lot about, but I think everyday people don't really understand what it is. So essentially it's an internship program to get young people, 17 to 24, off the dole, off welfare, and into work. But it's an internship program. So if I'm Woolworths, the government pay me $1,000 to put on an intern who can work up to 25 hours a week for 3 months, but I don't have to pay them. The government just gives them $100 a week on top of the Centrelink allowance. So it works out, if you work the full 25 hours a week, $4 an hour you're getting paid to stack shelves at Woolies. Now, only one third of the young people that go into this program actually end up with permanent work.
Yeah.
So people are saying it's exploitative. Kind of feels like it is
a
little bit.
Yeah, it kind of feels like it is.
And
yeah.
It's that concern about exploitation, but also the effectiveness. At the end of that, are you seeing people successfully enter the jobs market on payment?
No.
Yeah, what skills are they getting?
And they've got other parts of this program where they subsidise wages for people. So people get the full whack of wage that they should deserve entitled to under the award, and that's keeping people in work. Well, doesn't that tell you that if you pay people properly, that's rewarding for them and they go to work?
Yeah.
If you're giving them $4 an hour on top of the Centrelink allowance, that doesn't make anyone feel good.
Parliament is back shortly. What is on the agenda for the next sitting week?
Well, they've got a few things on the go, but I think one of the main things is going to be this round of national security legislation that they are going to try and push through. And one of the main bills that's linked to that is, of course, the Medivac, the much hyped Medivac legislation that they're going to try and repeal, and that'll be a bit of a test for Labor, I imagine, even though they've made their position very clear.
It'll be a bit of a test for the government, I think, in the Senate specifically, because they've built a relationship with the crossbench Senate Alliance even in just the last sitting week, first sitting week of the new Parliament, with Senator Alliance and Jackie Lambie. You know, the Senator Alliance have said, hey, listen, we've essentially got a voting block of three. You need four to get, with Corey Bernardi, you need four of us to get legislation through in the future, and repealing Medivac could damage our relationship going forward. Is it worth it? I don't know.
Yeah, although you can imagine that Peter Dutton would be pretty smug if they managed to repeal that legislation.
No, wouldn't he?
He'd be pretty pleased. What is not on the agenda is legislation for some of the recommendations that were made by Kenneth Hayne during the Banking Royal Commission. The government says it may get to them by the end of the year. Labor says that that's not good enough and it needs to pull its finger out. What's the delay, do you think?
Well, I think the APRA stuff was interesting this week, you know, saying that APRA needs to do its job. Well, you know, breaking news. They're the prudential, you know, they're the regulator.
Watchdog,
they're the watchdog. And the banks have been playing up for how long, you know? I think the government needs to get on with this. You know, they're philosophically and ideologically tied to the banks, and the banks have been taking the mickey out of Australia for however long.
Yeah.
We found that out during the Royal Commission. It was an utter disgrace, you know, charging people when they're dead, for God's sake.
Yeah,
you
know? And the Prime Minister...
And the government needs to just to go,
And the Prime Minister, as Treasurer, opposed a Royal Commission for a really long time here, so I think that this is a difficult issue for him, potentially. I think if I was Labor, I'd be making a pretty big deal out of that right about now.
Yeah, it's pretty clear, right, given, you know, following the Royal Commission, that the mood has changed, you know, that people are... rightfully very angry at the banks and they want something to be done. As you say, things just need to happen, and with APRA, that era of the regulator being very chummy with the sector and this revolving door of people going between the regulator and the institutions that are being regulated, it has to be over. They have to be tough. They have to be taking on these very powerful institutions that have cultural issues.
All right, just finally, before we go, I want to give the award for the worst press conference location to Anthony Albanese, who did a press conference right next to a bell tower. Have a look.
The Australian government, there we go.
This one goes for ages.
One of the things that it sometimes... There we go.
Pretty awkward, not going Albo's way. Thanks for watching How Good Is Politics? And if you have a question or a comment, you can leave it under the community tab and we may read it out on next week's show.